Let's take a look at the posterior pituitary. Our first real posterior pituitary hormone here is ADH. Now, even though there are only two hormones that we'll be addressing here with posterior pituitary, my goodness, the clinical applications of this are massive, as you shall see. First, what is this particular illustration showing us? Understand where you are. We're in the collecting duct. We're in the kidney. And we're moving from our cortex into the medulla. And I want you to imagine that beyond the collecting duct, where it says urine osmolarity of being 1200, beyond this, we're going into our minor major calyces and then out towards the pelvis and towards the ureter. Are we clear as to where we are now? And this is not the loop of Henle. We're in the kidney, and we're in the level of the collecting duct. And then here, with ADH, we'll be referring to its receptor being V2 receptors. And with V2 receptors, remember, we talked about the vasopressin with V2 receptors, and its second messenger here will be GS, in fact. Not GQ, but GS. So in the distal convoluted tubule, it's responsible for increased water reabsorption, thus, with the help of ADH only in the collecting duct, can it move up to 1200. Now, they can ask a physical question here by saying that without the effect of ADH on the nephron, where is it in the nephron that your urine osmolarity would be the highest? It would have to be the loop, right? Are you picturing, and by that I mean the descending loop of Henle, where you're reabsorbing your water, but that has nothing to do with ADH, does it? Right? It's only after you've understood that point in which this sentence here, where with the help of ADH and V2 receptors, reabsorbing water, you then form concentrated urine. Next, a different location altogether. This is not the collecting duct. This is not the nephron. This is in reference to ADH and its effect via V1 receptors on your blood vessels where we are here. Look at the arrows that you see here with ADH, and with the help of it, you'll notice that the blood vessel here on top is a lot more narrow in caliber than it is at the bottom. It kind of looks like a flask. And the only reason that it looks like this is because when a patient is dehydrated, when releasing ADH, it is responsible for vasoconstriction, and this would be V1. Along with this, understand that ADH will then promote the release of von Willibrand factor and factor 8 via endothelium. Endothelium, of course, being the cells of your blood vessel, and you should remember that von Willibrand factor and factor 8 work together for optimum hemodynamic functioning. So vasopressin analogs for the management of von Willebrand type 1 and hemophilia could be used effectively, can't it? Amazing management vignette here, isn't it? It's a fact that you may use an analog of vasopressin. If you're thinking about von Willebrand disease type 1, understand that you're deficient of von Willebrand factor. And if you're deficient of von Willibrand factor, remember that patient who has massive menorrhagia and the fact that you have increase in bleeding time and PTT. Why? Because you need von Willibrand factor for optimum functioning of factor 8. So therefore, a vasopressin analog could in fact be used in this condition. And then what about hemophilia A? Hemophilia A is strictly a deficiency of factor 8. Hence, you would only find an increase in PTT. Here, once again, vasopressin could be used to perhaps manage a patient with hemophilia A by releasing factor 8. At supraphysiologic levels of ADH, it works on V1 receptors to cause vasoconstriction. It's important for you to understand that. So you need really high levels of ADH. So you need to have a patient who is quite severely dehydrated, in which the influence of ADH on your blood vessels would be taking place. at low levels of ADH, as soon as our plasma osmolarity rises, let's say above 300, then your ADH will be released from the posterior pituitary. Just to keep things into perspective, ADH is being synthesized where? In the hypothalamus.